There's an old man called the Mississippi. That's the old man that I'd like to be.
Welcome to the Not Old Better Show. I'm your host, Paul Vogelsang. Our guest today, Robert Wyatt, an American music specialist, researcher, and pianist, and presenter of the Smithsonian Associates event, Jerome Kern, the Godfather of American Musical Theater, on May 18th, 2017, says, Jerome Kern did it all and is where it all began.
Kern was like the beginning of it all.
Jerome Kern first began to get some real attention when his hits such as Old Man River, which you're listening to now, sung by Paul Robeson, and Kern's work with collaborators Oscar Hammerstein, Guy Bolton, and P.G. Wodehouse caught the music-loving public's attention with musicals that successfully wedded Kern's great music, lyrics, and libretto. Kern's transformative work with musicals, such as his famous musical play Showboat, famous for Old Man River, again, listening to this by Paul Robeson, Can't Help But Love It, and other songs like Can't Help Lovin' That Man of Mine. As part of our Smithsonian Associates series, today we speak to pianist and research expert Robert Wyatt about Jerome Kern, the godfather of American musical theater. Please join me in welcoming to the Not Old Better Show, Robert Wyatt, who will be presenting at the Ripley Center, Washington, D.C., May 18th, 2017. Well, we are with American music specialist and pianist Robert Wyatt, who will be at the Ripley Center in downtown D.C. on May 18th. Robert's going to be talking about Jerome Kern, the godfather of American musical theater. Robert, it is a pleasure to talk to you. I have done a fair bit of research on you, a fair bit of research on Jerome Kern. I just didn't know nearly the extent that I probably needed to about this man. But tell us first about yourself, and then tell us a little bit about the program on May 18th and Jerome Kern, because this is just going to be a wonderful program. Exciting, wonderful music that I just didn't even know about that we're going to touch on, but I hate to sound so giddy, but Robert, take it, please, and stop me, because this is going to be great.
Well, my musical theater career began when I was 14 years old, and wow. My mother took me to see Brigadoon, and I'd only seen one Gilbert and Sullivan show, HMS Pinafore, once before. Well, when I saw, you know, that show, I just decided, hey, I want to become a musician. So I did, and I am. So I play the piano, and I talk about music. And Jerome Kern, in all the different programs I've done, he's one of my most favorite because he's such an influence on all of music theater. He really was the beginning, and it was Jerome Kern that started the whole thing off. And then he went, you know, until he died. So he made lots of films. He made, 1,350 songs, you know, 100 different stage shows. So he just did everything. He made a lot of films.
And he was
so
a young man.
So Jerome Kern is the...
Yeah, sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt you, but he did so much, and he really passed away at age 60.
Yeah. Well, that's nothing compared to Gershwin, who was 38, you know. But Kern lived a long time, and he also just worked from the very beginning of time. You know, he wrote twice the songs that Gershwin did. So he was, his goal was to write a song a day. And, you know, I would imagine that sometimes he wrote songs in half a day. But, you know, he could put together a whole show in like 8 to 10 days. So he was a person who really knew how to play the piano, enjoyed playing the piano. And whenever he played the piano, something creative came off his fingers. And he was magical. He was a real curmudgeon. You know, he was a pain in the neck. gave everybody a tough time. In fact, he once even told a new director, he said, I hear you're a son of a bitch, and I am too.
Oh, to be talented like that.
Yeah. Well, he was, by the time he got to Showboat, and well, really by the time he passed Showboat, he became one of the number one people. So he made films and Broadway shows and everything because he was at the top.
Well, let's talk about Showboat. Certainly that's what, again, from my research, what he really seems to be best known for among many, many things. But Showboat was wonderful. Talk a little bit about some of that music, because Paul Robeson, Old Man River, all of those great songs we can get into. But let's start with Showboat.
Well, Showboat was, really the end of the old type of Broadway show and the beginning of the new type of Broadway show. There's a wonderful quote by Miles Kruger, who's sort of like the godfather of the American musical theater. He knows everything about musical theater. And he said, the history of the American musical theater, quite simply, is divided into two eras, everything before Showboat and everything after Showboat.
And what was so special about Showboat?
Well, Showboat was so talking, in a musical theater before that had been mainly good times, laughs and jokes and love and, you know, when it got to Showboat, you were talking about biracial activities, you were talking about alcoholism, you were talking about segregation. It was a tough, you know, thing. It was Florence Ziegfeld, the Ziegfeld guy from New York. He was producing it, so it got all of the money and all of the time that it needed because it was just a beautifully crafted show, and it was produced so well. So it lasts a long time, and it's the only musical by Jerome Kern that's really used in the repertoire today. No one does anything else with the 100-plus shows except Showboat. That's it.
We're going to listen to a little bit of Paul Robeson's version of Old Man River, which is stunning and probably the version. But there was controversy about casting for this program, as you talk about racial issues. Tell us a little bit about that, too, because there were lines crossed here.
Well, there were, and this was still the era where there were lots of lynchings going on in the South, and to write a show about, you know, the rich Southern people coming up to the docks when the Showboat pulled in, and the Showboat was run by black people. And so Paul Robeson had been the original cast member when Jerome Kern wrote the song in 1926, and but it took a long time to get it together, and they had to give up the entire cast because they couldn't get it done in 1926. So when they got to 1927, the cast had to be rehired, and Paul Robeson was not ready. So another guy had to sing Old Man River, and then Paul Robeson took over after that. You know, all the revivals and the movies, that was all Paul Robeson. It's what the piece was written for him, so it's, you know, it's authentic.
And as I say, we're going to be playing some of this, and for our audience, you're hearing a little bit about Paul Robeson from our guest today, Robert Wyatt. And Robert Wyatt will be at the Ripley Center in Washington, D.C. on May 18th, talking about Jerome Kern, who is known also as the godfather of the American musical. I think one of the things that just was so interesting in my research of you, Robert, is you really define yourself as a piano player who does research.
Yes. That's
a great combination of things. So tell us a little bit about your research on, say, for example, Old Man River. What are some of your favorite lines from that song as we're listening to it?
Well, when you talk about Old Man River, it all comes down to one quote, and it's by Edna Ferber. And she had written the novel, Showboat, which came out in 1926, the year before. And that's when Ziegfeld was going to make the show, but it took him too long. So Edna Ferber was living in the same building as Jerome Kern. And she says, as the writing of the musical play proceeded, I heard bits and pieces of the score. I had heard Can't Help Lovin' That Man with its love, the music. I had melted under bewitching strains of make-believe and Why Do I Love You? And then Jerome Kern appeared at my apartment late one afternoon with a strange look of quiet exultation in his eyes. He sat down at the piano, he played and sang Old Man River. The music mounted, and I give you my word, my hair stood on end. The tears came to my eyes, I breathed like a heroine in a melodrama. This was great music. This was music that would outlast Jerome Kern's day and mine. And she really went on to say that no one will remember you, Jerome, because they'll remember the song, but not you. That's the case. When you listen to all these songs, you said, oh, yeah, I love that song. It's by whom? Jerome Kern? Really? I was so surprised.
Well, among you kindly, Robert, you sent me several songs that are wonderful representation of Jerome Kern's work, and we're going to listen to a fine romance also. And in the version that you sent me, which I'll put up a link to, and we're listening to it now, of course, the audience, but both Ella Fitzgerald and Louis Armstrong sing this, A Fine Romance. Yeah, just gorgeous.
Yeah, I know that recording. It's fantastic.
What is it about that? I mean, the music for Jerome Kern, someone who, during an era of great racial tension, something we're experiencing now, but to tap into just some of the beauty and the words, and he really knew what he was talking about there in A Fine Romance.
Well, he did. He was a wonderful man. He had a nice marriage. He was, you know, he was a tough guy, but he was a fun guy. And he wrote A Fine Romance with Dorothy Fields, who was, of all the, you know, lyricists, she was probably the one that he loved the most. So the two of them got together for A Fine Romance, and, you know, it just really knocked their socks off. And then The Way You Look Tonight was from the same movie. So Dorothy Fields and Jerome Kern were a pair.
Interestingly enough, too, and you sent me this version, and I'll put up a link to it, The Way You Look Tonight, the Frank Sinatra version. These songs, they do live on today. I noticed that 27 million people have viewed and listened to that song on YouTube. So almost
really,
as pop.
It really doesn't surprise me. You know, only about 15 of his songs have become standards, but some of them, and they're just sung by everyone. You can hear Billie Holiday, you can hear Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, you know, everyone sings Jerome Kern.
Yeah, and Judy Garland's version of Smoke Gets in Your Eyes is just stunning, too. Almost, I wanted to ask you, too, was that written for Judy? Did Jerome Kern write Smoke Gets in Your Eyes for
Judy? No. Smoke Gets in Your Eyes came from a show called Roberta in 1935. And then Arthur Freed, who was the music director there at MGM Studios, he wanted to write a movie about Jerome Kern, just like he'd written one about Rodgers and Hart. So he actually, Jerome Kern, you know, came to the studio and was working on the movie about himself. And then he took a break after a few weeks, and he went to New York, and he died. So Arthur Freed had to get rid of all that stuff, and he started the movie over, and they made it into a wonderful thing. But they got all these stars. There's nothing finer than Frank Sinatra singing Old Man. Everything's in white, and there's Frank Sinatra singing Old Man River. Oh, it's the funniest thing I've ever seen in a movie.
Well, I listened to all of
this. I'm sorry, I got off track because the Judy Garland is one of the stars that was hired. They had a cast of like 10 really famous people. Judy Garland sang that one. So.
Yeah, and beautiful, just a beautiful.
It was not written for her, though. It's not written for her.
I really spent so much time looking into this music and found so much that I've come to enjoy it. It's all going through my head now, and certainly we're going to play this. But again, Robert Wyatt will be at the Ripley Center in Washington, D.C. on May 18th. This is going to be a treat. Robert, it's such a pleasure to talk to you. What else can you tell our audience about Jerome Kern that maybe is one of those stories that is unique to him?
Oh, yes. I have this story. So Jerome Kern and Ira Gershwin were working together for a movie called Cover Girl, and it was one of the last that Jerome Kern made. And he insisted that everybody who was writing with him come over to his home in Hollywood. And well, Ira Gershwin only lived three blocks away, but you had to work with Jerome Kern at his house. So Ira Gershwin would have to walk down to Jerome Kern's. And, you know, he hated writing Long Ago and Far Away because he didn't like being with Jerome Kern. So he went home and he waited and waited. And finally, Jerome Kern sent him the music and said, listen, it's going to be recorded tomorrow. You've got to finish the lyrics. So Ira Gershwin phoned in the lyrics to Long Ago and Far Away by phone. And then Jerome Kern went to film it with Gene Kelly. Well, Gene Kelly was a dancer, not a singer. So he sang it for Jerome Kern, thinking that Kern would just lambast him. And Kern said, I have only one thing to ask of you, Mr. Kelly. He said, would you please sing it again?
Oh, gosh.
I love the way he sang it so much. That's probably way too long, but it's
no,
a good story.
That is a great story. Robert Wyatt, what a pleasure it is to talk to you. Thank you for joining us today on the show. We're going to look forward to seeing you May 18th at the Ripley Center. It will be a pleasure to see and hear from you there. I'll look forward to meeting you on the 18th at the Ripley Center. But Robert Wyatt, what a pleasure. I'm so glad we had a chance to talk and get together and chat about Jerome Kern.
I am too. Thank you, Paul.
Absolutely. Thanks, Robert.
He just keeps rolling. He keeps on.